Hello students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Vishal from Maharaja Agar Sain University, Badi, Himachal Pradesh. Today, we are going to discuss about the module Financing International Trade under the paper International Business Operations. Students, after completing this module, you will be able to understand the meaning and concept of Financing International Trade. Know about the role of commercial banks in financing international trade and understand various instruments of financing international trade. International trade transactions involve at least two parties, that is, seller or exporter and buyer or importer. The nature of international transaction is altogether different from domestic trade in respect of payment, delivery, and maturity. For example, both importer and exporter, being resident of different countries, they are living top four to each other, speaking different languages, living in different political environment, using different currencies, having different culture and religion, etc. Further, they both know that they have different standard of honoring obligations to each other. In case of default, the other party will have a hard time catching up to seek redress. Hence, foreign trade transactions involve more risk in comparison to home trade. Since, due to long distance, it is not possible to simultaneously hand over goods with one hand and accept payment with the other, the importer would prefer the following. If this is done, then all risk is shifted to the exporter, which he may not agree. The exporter would like the opposite of this. Being stranger to each other, importer and exporter, and unwilling to trust a stranger, the problem would be solved by using a highly respected bank as intermediary. In that situation, the importer obtained the bank's promise to pay on his behalf. Knowing the exporter will trust the bank, then the exporter ships the goods to the importer's country. Title of the goods is given to the bank on a document. The exporter asks the bank to pay for the goods to the importer's country. The exporter asks the bank to pay for the goods and the bank does so. After that, the bank, having paid for the goods, now passes title to the importer whom the bank trusts. The importer reimburses the bank. In brief, it is observed that a strong exporter can finance the entire trade from his own funds by extending credit until the importer pays in cash. Alternatively, the importer can finance the entire by paying cash in advance to the exporter. However, due to risk factors, some in-between approach is followed, that is, involving one or more financial intermediaries. Role of commercial banks in financing international trade. Commercial banks play a pivotal role in the development of international trade. Without commercial banks, the international finance and import and export industry would not exist. Commercial banks make possible the reliable transfer of funds and transaction of business practices between different countries and different customs all over the world. The global nature of commercial banking also makes possible the distribution of valuable economic and business information among customers and the capital markets of all countries. Commercial banking also serves as a worldwide barometer of economic health and business trends. The following instruments are offered by commercial banks for meeting the requirements of importers and exporters. Letter of credit. Letter of credit is an instrument issued by a bank at the request of the importer, in which the bank promises to pay a particular sum of amount to beneficiary presenting specified document in the letter of credit. Letter of credit is also known as commercial letter of credit, a documentary letter of credit, or simply a credit. It means letter of credit reduces the risk of non-completion of the transaction. Essence of the agreement. The letter of credit is a letter addressed to the seller, written and signed by a bank acting on behalf of the buyer. The essence of letter of credit is the promise by a bank to pay against specific documents which must accompany any draft drawn against the credit. The letter of credit is not a guarantee of the underlying transaction between a bank and designated beneficiary and separate from the commercial transaction. For a true letter of credit, following elements must be present with respect to the issuing bank. Number one, the bank must receive a fee for issuing the letter of credit. Number two, letter of credit must contain a specified expiration date or definite maturity. Number three, the letter of credit must specify stated maximum amount of money to pay. Number four, the bank's obligation must arise only on presentation of specified documents. And number five, the customer's unqualified obligation to reimburse the bank on the same condition as the bank has paid. Types of letter of credit. The following are types of letter of credit. Revocable letter of credit. A revocable letter of credit may be revoked or modified for any reason at any time by issuing bank without notification. It is rarely used in international trade and not considered satisfactory for the exporters, but has an advantage over that of the importers and the issuing bank. There is no provision for confirming revocable credits as per the terms of UCPDC. Hence, they cannot be confirmed. It should be indicated in letter of credit that credit is revocable. If there is no such indication, the credit will be deemed as irrevocable. Next is irrevocable letter of credit. In this case, it is not possible to revoke or amend a credit without the agreement of the issuing bank, the confirming bank, and the beneficiary. From an exporter's point of view, it is believed to be more beneficial. An irrevocable letter of credit from the issuing bank ensures the beneficiary that if the required documents are presented and the terms and conditions are complied with, payment will be made. Confirmed letter of credit. Confirmed letter of credit is a special type of letter of credit in which another bank apart from the issuing bank has added its guarantee. Although the cost of confirming by two banks makes it costlier, this type of letter of credit is more beneficial for the beneficiary as it doubles the guarantee. Site credit and usance credit. Site credit states that the payments would be made by the issuing bank at site on demand or on presentation. In case of usance credit, draft is drawn on the issuing bank or the correspondent bank at specified usance period. The credit will indicate whether the usance drafts are to be drawn on the issuing bank or, in the case of confirmed credit, on the confirming bank. Back-to-back letter of credit. Back-to-back letter of credit is also termed as countervailing credit. A credit is known as back-to-back credit when a letter of credit is opened with security of another letter of credit. A back-to-back credit, which can also be referred as credit and counter credit, is actually a method of financing both sides of a transaction in which a middleman buys goods from one customer and sells them to another. The parties to a back-to-back letter of credit are, number one, the buyer and his bank as the issuer of the original letter of credit. Number two, the seller or manufacturer and his bank. And number three, the manufacturer's subcontractor and his bank. Transferable letter of credit. A transferable documentary credit is a type of credit under which the first beneficiary, which is usually a middleman, may request the nominated bank to transfer credit in whole or in part to the second beneficiary. The letter of credit does state clearly mentions the margins of the first beneficiary, and unless it is specified, the letter of credit cannot be treated as transferable. It can only be used when the company is selling the product of a third party and the proper care has to be taken about the exit policy for the money transactions that take place. This type of letter of credit is used in the companies that act as a middleman during the transaction but don't have large limit. In the transferable letter of credit, there is a right to substitute the invoice and the whole value can be transferred to a second beneficiary. The first beneficiary or middleman has rights to change the following terms and conditions of the letter of credit. Reduce the amount of credit. Reduce unit price if it is stated. Make shorter the expiry date of the letter of credit. Make shorter the last date for presentation of documents. Make shorter the period for shipment of goods. Increase the amount of the cover or percentage for which insurance cover must be effected. Substitute the name of the applicant or the middleman for that of the first beneficiary, the buyer. The draft, commonly used in international trade, a draft is also called a bill of exchange or first of exchange. It is unconditional order written by an exporter instructing an importer or his agent to pay a specified amount of money at a specified time. A draft can become a negotiable instrument in the following requirements are fulfilled. Number one, it must be in writing and signed by the maker or drawer or originator. Number two, it must contain an unconditional promise to pay. Number three, amount must be specified and certain to pay. Number four, it must be payable on demand or at a definite future date. And number five, it must be payable on demand to order or to the bearer. In brief, there are usually three parties to the draft. One, who signs and sends the draft to second, called the dry. Payment is made to the third party, the payee. Normally, the drawer and the payee may be the same person. Drafts are of two types, site draft and time drafts. A site draft is payable on presentation to the dry. It means the dry must pay at once or dishonor the draft. On the other hand, when drafts are payable at specified future date and as such become a useful finance device, it is also known as usance or tenor draft. When a time draft is drawn on and accepted by a bank, it becomes a banker's acceptance. If the draft is drawn on and as accepted by business fulfill, then it becomes a trade acceptance. Further, a draft can be clean or documentary. A clean draft is that draft which is not accompanied by any paper and normally is used in non-trade remittances. A documentary draft is accompanied by documents that are to be delivered to the DRAI on payment or acceptance of the draft. Normally, these documents include the bill of lading in negotiable form, the commercial invoice, the consular invoice, and the insurance certificates, etc. Bill of lading. Another important document in international trade is the bill of lading. The bill of lading is issued to the exporter by a common carrier transporting the goods, merchandise. It serves three purposes, such as receipt, a contract, and a document of title. Number one, as a receipt, the bill of lading indicates that carrier or transporter has received the goods from the exporter described on the face of document. Usually, the carrier is not responsible for ascertaining that the containers hold what is alleged to be their contents. So, description of goods on the bill of lading is usually short and simple. Number two, as a contract. The bill of lading describes the contract between the carrier and exporter in which the former agrees to carry the goods from port of shipment to port of destination in return for a certain charges. And number three, as a document of title. The bill of lading is used to obtain payment or a written promise of payment before the goods are released to the importer. It is also used as a collateral against which funds may be advanced to the exporter by its local banker. A bill of lading can be either straight or to order. Former consigns the goods to a specific party, normally the importer, and is not negotiable. Since the title cannot be transferred to third party, hence it is not good collateral or title and is used only when no financing is involved under an order, bill of lading.
The goods can be consigned to the order of a named party, usually the exporter. In this way, the exporter retains title until it endorses the bill of lading on the reverse side. Other techniques of financing of international trade. The following are other important techniques which are available to MNCs for financing their trade. Bankers' acceptance. Bankers' acceptance is an important method of assisting international trade in which a banker accepts the time draft drawn on it by the exporter. By accepting the draft, the bank makes an unconditional promise to pay the holder of the draft a stated amount on a specified date. In this way, by accepting the draft, it creates a negotiable instrument which is freely traded in the money market. Mechanism of the banker's acceptance. Important steps which are taken in creating the banker's acceptance have been discussed here in brief.
Firstly, an importer of merchandise seeks credit to finance its purchase until the goods can be resold. For this purpose, he requests the banker to issue a letter of credit on its behalf, authorizing the foreign exporter to draw a time draft on the bank in payment of the goods. Secondly, after getting the authorization from the importer bank, then the exporter ships the goods on an order bill of lading made out to itself and presents a time draft and the endorsed documents to its banker. Thirdly, the exporter's bank after that sends all these documents to the importer's bank. Documents include the time draft, shipping documents, etc. The importer's bank then accepts the draft and thus creates a banker's acceptance and sends back to the exporter's bankers. Fourthly, the exporter discounts the draft with the accepting bank and receives payment for the shipment. Fifthly, the shipping documents are delivered to the importer and the importer may now claim the shipment. Sixthly, the accepting bank may now either buy the banker's acceptance and hold it in its own portfolio investment or sell the banker acceptance in the money market. The maturities of banker's acceptances vary and normally range from 30 days to 180 days, with the average being 90 days. Maturities should cover the entire period needed to ship and dispose of the goods financed. On the maturity date, the accepting bank will pay the current holder the stated amount on the draft. The holder of banker's acceptance can recover his full amount from the last endorser in case the importer is not willing to pay at maturity. Authenticity of banker's acceptance is separated from the underlying transaction, and that banker acceptance is not dishonored for reason of a dispute between the exporter and the importer. As a result, this factor enhances marketability of a banker's acceptance and reduces its riskiness. Discounting. As we have seen that the trade draft has been accepted by the importer's bank, then draft takes the shape of banker's acceptance. Even if a trade draft is not accepted by a bank, the exporter can still convert the trade draft into cash by means of discounting. Hence, discounting is another technique of getting funds other than from the importer's bank, like financial institution or other banks. The exporter gets the amounts of the draft, less interest and commission on the same. Normally, the shipping documents and other papers are duly insured from an insurance agency against both commercial and political risk.
In case of losses, the insurer will reimburse the exporter or any other financial institution to which the exportee transfers the draft. The discount rate on these papers is normally lower to interest rate on overdraft facilities, bank loans, and other funding techniques. This is partly due to government's policy to promote exporters. The discounting can be of two types, like with recourse and without recourse. In case of with recourse, the discounting bank can collect from the exporter if the importer fails to pay on the maturity. Whereas in non-recourse, the bank bears the collection risk of the draft.
Factoring. Factoring is another important technique of financing foreign trade. In this technique, the firm or the exporters sell their accounts receivable to the factor at a discount to enhance the liquidity. By issuing a factor, a firm can ensure that its terms are in accord with the local practice and are competitive. Usually, under factoring, customers can be offered payment on open account rather than being asked for a letter of credit or stiffer credit requirements.
Factoring can be with recourse and non-recourse. In with recourse factoring, the exporter assumes the risks if the debtors do not make payment to the factor, whereas in non-recourse factoring, the factor assumes all the credit and political risks except for those involving dispute between the transaction parties. Most factoring in practice is done on the basis of non-recourse. Factor charges a fee for his service rendered to the exporter. This fee is decided on an individual company basis and is normally related to the annual turnover. In general, this fee varies from 1.75% to 2% of sales. Forfeiting. Forfeiting is another specialized factoring technique used in case of extreme credit risk. In the field of export financing, when the accounts receivable of an exporter are factored, whereby the exporter gives up the right to receive payment in favor of forfeiter, the transaction is known as forfeiting. In other words, forfeiting is normally without recourse, which is discounting of medium-term export receivables denominated in fully convertible currencies like US dollar, Swiss franc, pound, dash mark, etc. This technique is used normally in capital goods exports with a 5-year maturity and repayments in semi-annually installments. The forfeiting fee is at a fixed rate, normally 1.25% above lender interbank rate or local cost of funds. This technique is very much popular in Western countries. Institutional financing. In export financing, most of the governments of developed and non-developed countries have attempted to provide their domestic exporters with a competitive edge in the form of low-cost assistance and concessionary rates on political and economic risk insurance. Normally, government itself or through any agency like Export-Import Bank and other financial institutions provide financial assistance to the exporters. This assistance is normally classified into two categories, pre-shipment credit and post-shipment credit.
So students, let's summarize what we have learned in this module. In this module, we have learned about various financing instruments used in international trade. As we have discussed, commercial banks play a pivotal role in financing international trade. Without commercial banks, the international finance and import-export industry would not exist. Commercial banks make possible the reliable transfer of funds and translation of business practices between different countries and different customs all over the world. The global nature of commercial banking also makes possible the distribution of valuable economic and business information among customers and the capital markets of all countries. Commercial banking also serves as a worldwide barometer of economic health and business trends. Letter of credit, bill of lading, banker's acceptance, discounting, draft, factoring, forfeiting, etc. are some of the instruments discussed in this module, which are used for financing international trade transactions. In export financing, most of the governments of developed and non-developed countries have attempted to provide their domestic exporters with a competitive edge in the form of low-cost assistance and concessionary rates. This assistance is normally classified into two categories, that is pre-shipment credit and post-shipment credit. Thank you very much.